Velkommen alle sammen her til gudstjeneste i Odense Vineyard, og det var lidt højt. jeg håber, I har lyst til at bare have en rigtig, rigtig dejlig søndag formiddag her. Rigtig hjertelig velkommen til jer alle sammen. Hvis du er ny her, hvis du er gæst, så vil jeg også bare sige tusind tak, fordi du er kommet, og vi håber, at du vil føle dig rigtig hjertelig velkommen her. Vi skal bruge noget tid sammen her, hvor vi både skal synge lovsangen til Gud. Det bruger vi cirka 20-25 minutter på. Så skal vi dele nadver sammen. Så har vi nogle forskellige, så er der et program for børnene, og så skal vi høre lidt om, hvad foregår der i kirken. Og så bagefter så skal vi høre en rigtig spændende tale af Abby, som sidder her. Og Abby, hun er trådt til her i sidste øjeblik, fordi vi skulle egentlig have haft Henriette Winkel til at tale i dag, men hun er desværre blevet forhindret. Så Abby, hun har et budskab med til os i dag, der handler om bøn, og hun kommer til at tale på engelsk. Men det er først efter pausen, men du kan allerede forberede dig nu på, at hvis du gerne vil have oversættelse til dansk, når Abby taler på engelsk, så skal du have fat i sådan et headset, som er herude i gangen. Men jeg skal nok lige gøre opmærksom på det igen. Ja. Jeg ved ikke, om I kunne tænke jer lige at rejse jer op. Og så vil vi lige bede sammen og invitere Guds nærvær til at komme og være med os her. Og så vil jeg bare lige sige, at den allerførste sang, vi skal synge, den er jo rigtig særlig sjov, hvis man er børn, barnlige sjæl, eller bare godt kunne tænke sig at bevæge sig lidt. Der kommer nogle fantastiske mennesker her og viser os, hvordan vi kan bevæge os til den. Ja. Men vi siger bare tak, Fader, fordi at du er her. Tak, Gud. Vi vil bare prise dig, vi vil sige dig tak, fordi at du er den, som kender os, du er den, som vi får liv fra, du er den, som fylder os med glæde. Og jeg beder om, at alle, som er her i dag, at du bare vil være tæt på os hver især. Ja, amen. Take it away.
Vi kender kongen, hele jorden skaber, en frelser og befrier. Vi er hans børn. Hans seer er værdifuld, en super vigtig fighter, en uundværlig ener. Vi er hans børn. Kongebørn, kongebørn. Guds familie, fra nu af og til evig tid. Kongebørn, kongebørn, en del af Guds familie, fra nu af og til evig tid. Han siger kom til alle. Vi er hans børn. Kan du høre hans stemme? Den kalder i dit hjerte. Ellers kan du lære det. Vi er hans børn. Kongebørn, kongebørn. En del af Guds familie. Fra nu af og til evig tid. Kongebørn, kongebørn, en del af Guds familie, fra nu af og til evig tid. Oh, 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 yeah. Jesu navn, hvor skønt det klinger, lad det runge over jord. Intet andet verden bringer, håb og trøst som dette ord. For det navn må hadet vige, for det navn må ondskab fly. Færdsrige, skyde friske skud på ny. Navnet Jesus må jeg elske, det har sat min sjæl i brand. Ved det navn min sjæl fandt frelse, intet andet frelse kan. Midt i nattens mørke blinker, som et fyrtårn Jesu navn. Og hver nødsteg sejler vinker, ind i frelsens trygge havn. Og når solen mere ej skinner, Jesu navnet lyser af. Synger højtes pris i himmelen. Navnet Jesus må jeg elske, det har sat min sjæl i brand. Ved det navn min sjæl fandt frelse, intet andet frelse kan. Min sjæl i brand. Ved det navn min sjæl fandt frelse, intet andet frelse kan. Navnet Jesus må jeg elske, det har sat min sjæl i brand. Ved det navn min sjæl fandt frelse, intet andet frelse kan. I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a new revival stirring as we pray and see. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna. Heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what break yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the didn't want heaven without us.
So Jesus, you brought heaven down.
My sin was great, your love was greater. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you were raised to life again. You have no rival. You have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names.
Death could.
Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you.
Beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Ja, vi takker dig bare, far, fordi at vi kan være her sammen i dag. Tak fordi at du er midt i blandt os. Og vi skal bare til at fejre nadver sammen. Og det her med nadver, det jeg tænkte, nu vil jeg lige prøve at læse lidt om det. Det kan være, jeg måske lærer noget nyt. Så jeg fandt sådan en lille artikel på Kristeligt Dagblad. og der stod der blandt andet noget med, at i den første kirke, altså lige derefter Jesu død og genopstandelse, og da de begyndte at forme de kristne fællesskaber, så var det her med nadvaren faktisk også en måltid, som de delte sammen. Så det handlede rigtig meget om fællesskab for dem. Det handlede om fællesskab med hinanden, og det handlede selvfølgelig, og det handler selvfølgelig også om fællesskab med Jesus. Jeg havde egentlig bare sådan en fornemmelse af, at vi måske er nogen her i dag, som lige skulle tage os lidt ekstra sammen for at komme i dag. Hvis du er her i dag og tænker, jeg synes det der med fællesskab er lidt svært, så vil jeg bare fortælle dig, at det er du ikke alene om. Jeg kan også fortælle dig, at fordi det er der også nogle andre kloge mennesker, der har fortalt mig, når jeg har det sådan, at Jesus, han elsker, at vi er sammen. Også selvom, at vi er fulde af uperfektion, og vi ikke rigtig kan finde ud af det med hinanden nogle gange, eller hvad end det er, eller man ikke føler, man selv kan finde ud af det, så glæder Jesus sig bare så meget over os, når det er, vi samles. Tag det med. Han giver dig en kæmpe krammer. Han siger, hvor er det dejligt, du er her i dag sammen med os andre. Ja. Amen. Og jeg vil lige læse nadverteksten, som er den her sådan lidt traditionelle, at vi læser her fra 1. Korintherbrev kapitel 11. Og det er Paulus, der skriver: det følgende er, hvad jeg har modtaget fra Herren, og hvad jeg også har givet videre til jer. Den nat, da Herren Jesus blev forrådt, tog han et brød, takkede Gud, brækkede det over og sagde, dette er mit legeme, som gives for jer. Spis det for at huske på, hvad jeg har gjort. Efter måltid tog han også vinbægeret og sagde, dette bærer vin af mit blod, som besegler den nye pagt. Hver gang I drikker det, så husk på, hvad jeg har gjort. Indtil Herren kommer, forkynder I derfor budskabet om hans død, hver gang I spiser af brødet og drikker af bægeret. Og en af de andre ting, som også stod her i den her artikel, jeg fandt, det var, at de første kristne også så nadvaren som et udtryk for Jesu nærvær. Altså det her med, gør dette så ofte, som I drikker den til min ihukommelse. Så det vil sige, nadvaren er ikke sådan en mindefest, men ifølge teksten her er det faktisk en forkyndelse af, hvad betød det? Hvad betyder det for os i dag, at Jesus han døde og han genopstod for os, og vi har del med ham i den herlighed, som han har, altså herligheden i forhold til det forhold, han har med faderen. Så vi har et direkte forhold med Gud igennem det, han har gjort for os. Og så det er ikke noget, hvor det er, vi mindes noget, der er sket engang. Det er faktisk noget, som sker lige nu og her hver eneste dag. Ja. Så vi takker dig, Jesus, fordi at du gjorde det, som mennesket havde håbet på i årtusinder. Du tog det på dig, som vi ikke kunne. Du tog synden. Du tog det, vi ikke kunne gøre selv på dig og sagde, jeg tager skylden på mig. Og så overvinder jeg døden. Så det takker vi dig for, Jesus. Og vi takker dig, fordi at vi kan være sammen med dig om det. Og tage imod det. Ja. Vi beder, om du vil velsigne os her i dag. Vi beder, om du vil velsigne nadvaren. Amen. Ja. Og så er I velkomne alle sammen til nadver. Også er du ikke vant til at modtage nadver her i Odense Vineyard, så skal du vide, det er du rigtig hjertelig velkommen til at gøre. Der er både saft og vin, og der er et glutenfrit og laktosefrit knækbrød, du får, så det skulle være så sikkert som overhovedet muligt. Og så kan I se, at der er allerede en forerunner heroppe. Der er en der Ike er på pletten. Så det er faktisk bare at følge efter her. Ja, nemlig. Og så bliver der lagt et stykke brød i din hånd, og så vælger du selv, hvad du vil have at drikke. Så Velkommen til nadver.
Vi vil give dig det bedste vi har. Mund og hænder, alt hvad der er kostbar. Vi holder ikke igen, vær vort offer frem. Du fortjener mere, du er mere. Vi lægger alle ved dit kors, udstrakte arme, arme, tag imod. Vi lægger vi vil give dig det værste vi har. Mørke hjerter, nye sår og gamle ar. Vi holder ikke igen, vi bærer offer frem. Du så os da vi faldt, du kan bære.
Tusind tak til vores dejlige lovsangsband her, som er så dejligt søde at komme og lede os i lovsang. Er det ikke bare fantastisk? Jo, lige præcis. Lad os lige give dem en hånd. Nemlig. Og endnu en gang rigtig hjertelig velkommen også til dig, der måske er kommet til her under lovsangen. Vi har en dejlig gudstjeneste i dag, hvor vi blandt andet skal... der er et program for børnene, og der er en rigtig spændende tale her lidt senere. Først så skal vi lige høre, fordi i dag der sker der noget specielt med kids. Ja, må vi lige bede om at få Regitze herop, og kan lige give hende en hånd. Jubi! Og I kommer også med, sådan, og der er også en video til jer, så I bestemmer selv.
Vi springer videoen over, så fortæller vi noget spændende. Jamen, prøv at høre, der er kids gange to i dag. Det er jo simpelthen, så man kan blive helt begejstret. Og det er jo sådan, at for de 3-5-årige, så er der med Regitze, og den, der er over 5 og op til 12, det er sammen med mig. Og jeg hedder Ludvig, og vi med de store i dag, vi skal tale om tilbedelse, lovsang og sådan noget. Hvorfor gør man egentlig det? Hvordan gør man det? Hvordan fungerer det? Og alt muligt spændende. Så skal vi prøve at være lidt kreative med det. Så det er planen for de store. Og hvad skal I lave, Regitze?
Jamen, Minions, det er jo helt nyt og lige opstartet, og vi glæder os virkelig meget til at komme i gang. I dag, der skal vi starte helt fra begyndelsen af. Vi tager simpelthen skabelsen, hvor at, vi starter med at læse, høre bibelteksten, og så skal vi bygge med klodser bagefter, fordi vi skal jo selvfølgelig også bygge noget.
Så. Fedt. Sådan. Så er der nok en jingle, og så er I velkommen alle kids, alle børnene. Lige måde. Ses.
Man er velkommen til at virkelig at klappe med her. Jeg har fundet ud af, at hvis man bare klapper dobbelt, så rammer man altid på en eller anden måde i takt. Det er bare sådan et lille trick til jer. Yes. Og så er det sådan, her i Odense Vineyard, der er vi jo en kirke, som også elsker Jesus-historier. Og hvis du var med sidste søndag, så hørte du lidt mere om det. Og det er også, hvis du kan se, at vi har lidt balloner fra sidste søndag, der stadigvæk hænger. Og det er simpelthen det her med, at... Grunden til, at vi siger, at vi elsker Jesus historie, det er fordi, at vi elsker at sætte Jesus i centrum og lære af ham. Og vi elsker også at se, hvad det egentlig gør ved vores eget liv og ved andre menneskers liv. Og der har vi fået Kenneth i dag til at fortælle os, fordi han har en Jesus historie, så vi ikke lige giver ham en ordentlig hånd. Yes, Kenneth han sidder faktisk tit hernede i medieboksen, men nu kommer han op her, så take it away.
Yes, mange tak. Så jeg har sagt ja til at fortælle en Jesus-historie, og jeg må indrømme, det var først sådan her fra 20 minutter siden, jeg sådan rigtig begyndte med at tænke på, hvordan jeg egentlig ville fortælle den, så nu må vi se, om det bare bliver en hel masse mumbling, men jeg har en idé om, hvad jeg vil sige, så nu må vi se, hvor godt det bliver. Men jeg vil i hvert fald starte med at sige, at herfra omkring, lad mig egentlig starte et andet sted. Så det her, den historie, jeg kommer til at fortælle her, det er nok en af de største, der sådan er sket i mit liv. Og det vil jeg bare starte med at sige, og så kan jeg starte. Så omkring 4 år siden, der blev jeg færdig med at studere. Og der kom en Kenneth ud, som der var fuldstændig klar til at overtage verden, eller i hvert fald få sit første job i hvert fald. Jeg havde en idé om, at det første, der sker, det er nok, at jeg får et job her inden for de første 3 måneder, og så kan jeg begynde med at få en masse erfaring, og så kan jeg måske begynde på den her drøm, jeg har om også endelig måske at starte en virksomhed og virkelig gå efter det, som jeg tror, Gud han har for mig derude. Men det endte med, det overhovedet ikke var det, der kom til at ske. De første 3 måneder, der skete ikke rigtig noget, der kom ikke lige noget job, så gik der 3 måneder mere, og jeg begynder med at blive sådan lidt urolig for, altså, okay, er der nogen derude, der vil have mig? Men så gik der et år, der var stadigvæk ikke noget ellers med at have nogle praktikpladser, jeg fik sådan lidt erfaring, men efter et år, så begynder Kenneth med at være sådan lidt, okay, jeg havde ikke regnet med, at det var så svært, det her. Jeg troede egentlig, det ville være lidt mere lige til. Så går der et halvt år mere. Nu er Kenneth ved at være rigtig, okay, altså, kommer det job nogensinde? Ender det med, at nu har jeg ikke haft noget sådan rigtigt at stå op til i halvandet år. Hvis der er nogen af jer, der har prøvet det, så tror jeg, I ved, at det er rigtig, rigtig hårdt sådan for ens selvforståelse, det her med, at man ikke rigtig føler, at man kan tage sig af sig selv. Og det var faktisk nok det, som der egentlig gjorde allermest ondt på mig. Der ender også med at gå et halvt år mere, og efter det, så ved man jo i hvert fald, hvis man bor i Danmark i hvert fald, så begynder man med at tænke på, okay, så begynder man med at skal på det, der hedder kontanthjælp. Og det er heller aldrig rigtig noget, som man virkelig ønsker, men det sker jo for dem, som der er uheldige nok til ikke at finde noget job. Og det var så det, som jeg også skulle til at have en udsigt efter. Men det, der så alligevel sker lige inden det sker, det er, at jeg har faktisk en meget svær samtale med min præst Thomas. Og han siger, okay, Kenneth, jeg kan se, du har det virkelig ikke særlig godt nu. Og du har snakket om den her drøm her, du egentlig har med at starte virksomhed. Kunne det ikke være, at du måske bare skulle prøve kaste dig ud i det. Bare gør det. Håb på det bedste. Og stol på, at Gud han er med dig i det. Og jeg tænker lidt over det, og så går der et par dage, og så imens jeg faktisk går over ved en kammerat, over ved en kammerat og besøger ham, så om aftenen, så får jeg simpelthen den her virkelig, jeg bliver simpelthen ramt af Gud virkelig, virkelig stærkt der om aftenen, og hvor Gud han meget stærkt taler om, at Kenneth, alt den der tvivl om, at du ikke kan noget, du ikke har nogen kundskaber til det, du skal til for at få dit første job, eller starte virksomhed, eller noget af det her, det skal du bare gemme langt væk, fordi at jeg har givet dig alt det, som du har behov for. Jeg har lagt noget i dig, og jeg vil bygge dig op, jeg vil give dig alt det, som du har behov for, og så kan du formå at følge den drøm, som du havde. Og den oplevelse, den var så stærk, at jeg faktisk endte med så nogle få uger efter faktisk bare at kaste mig ud i det. Start virksomheden, og det var rigtig hårdt, og det endte faktisk også med det første halve år, at jeg faktisk mistede faktisk alle de penge, jeg havde. Det endte med, at faktisk endda endte med at skylde Niels, min rumbo, huslejen en enkelt måned. Jeg fik lidt arbejde her og der, men det der skete, det var faktisk, at jeg lærte at blive virkelig tæt på Gud i løbet af den her periode. Bare stole på, okay, nu har du sagt, jeg er med dig. Og så stolede jeg på, at han var med mig, selvom det ikke altid var nemt. Men det der så skete, det var simpelthen, at jeg fik landet en rigtig stor kunde, som nogen kender måske, der hedder Grundfos. Og så formåede jeg faktisk at leve af dem i det følgende halvandet år, indtil jeg så endte med faktisk at stoppe virksomheden, fordi jeg synes faktisk, det blev lidt ensomt. Men hele den her oplevelse med at faktisk følge den drøm, som Gud havde lagt i mig, og så se, at han faktisk gav mig alt det, jeg havde behov for, og faktisk trak mig op til at ikke have nogen tro sådan rigtigt på, at jeg kunne noget, til at vide, at med ham, så kan jeg faktisk følge de drømme, han har lagt i mig, og gå efter det, og formå også at gennemføre det. Det er noget af det største, der er sket i mit liv, og jeg vil også bare lade det være en opfordring til, at alle andre, der også har en eller anden drøm i dem, som de måske en gang imellem bare tænker, at det kan jeg ikke. Hvis du tror, at Gud har lagt det i dig, så gå efter det. Så vil han nok være med dig igen. Yes.
Tusind tak, Kenneth. Det er virkelig opmuntrende. Skal vi ikke lige give ham en ordentlig hånd? Lad os lige både ham og Jesus.
Ja.
Fedt. Jeg synes virkelig, også bare det her med, at du fortæller, at du bare er blevet ved med at stole på Gud i det her, hvor det viser bare, hvordan at Jesus han kan transformere vores liv, når det er, at vi stiller skarp fokus på ham. Ja, så tusind tak for at dele det, Kenneth. Og så vil, vi lige springe videre. Jeg har lidt forskellige informationer til jer inden pausen. For det første, så vil jeg bare lige fortælle, hvis du er ny her, og du ikke har fået en gratis Word-Bibel endnu, og du gerne vil have et nyt testamente, så du har mulighed for at læse Bibelen derhjemme, så er du meget hjertelig velkommen til at tage den med. Den ligger hernede på bordet. Lige nu har vi den på dansk, og der er nogle engelske på vej, så har du brug for en engelsk, så kom lige og snak med mig her. Ja. Og så er det sådan, at rundt omkring på jeres stole, der ligger der, for det første skal jeg lige sige, der ligger sådan en seddel her i dag, og den må I ikke lige krølle væk, fordi at den skal vi bruge, når det er, at Abby taler her senere i dag. Så der er en mening med, der ligger sådan en halv post-it her. Og ellers så ligger der sådan en folder her, som handler om, sådan bliver du en del af Odense Vineyard. Og det er for dig, som tænker, jeg synes egentlig, det er meget fedt at være her. Jeg kunne godt tænke mig at være en del af kirken. Så tag og kig i den her folder her. Hvis du kunne tænke dig at blive skrevet op som medlem, så udfyld den. Der er et kontaktkort her bagpå, og så læg den her ned i den sorte postkasse. Ja. Så har jeg lidt information om, hvad der sådan sker også her i kirken. Næste søndag, der har vi program for de store børn. Vi har Fusion, og det er for de 10-16-årige cirka. Så har du et barn i den her alder, så husk dem lige på det, at der er et super lækkert program for dem. Og de starter allerede 10:55, så der kommer man lige 5 minutter før, og så er de nemlig ude af huset og lave nogle super hyggelige aktiviteter sammen. Det sker en gang om måneden, det her Fusion. Og så sker der også noget andet for børnene. Det er sådan, at næste weekend, der har vi en Jard Danmark, det der hedder en juniorlejr, og det foregår i Middelfart, så det er ikke særlig langt væk. Det er for børn i 3. til 6. klasse, og der kan man tilmelde sig på det her link her, roskildevineyard.dk/juniorlejr, den hænger også herude. Der er stadigvæk mulighed for at melde sig til. Det er nogle super kompetente fantastiske mennesker, som står for det her. Det er en dejlig weekend, hvor børnene de bare kan bruge en masse tid på venskab og være sammen med Gud og alt muligt sjovt. Ja, så er det sådan, at den 28. april, det er også her i kirken, der holder vi det, der hedder halvårs. Og det er i forbindelse med vores almindelige gudstjeneste, så vi har en helt almindelig gudstjeneste her søndag den 28. april. Og så slutter vi af med, at når vi sidder og spiser sammen, så vil vi snakke om, så vil vi kigge lidt mere ind i maskinrummet i kirken. Hvordan går det med økonomi? Hvad drømmer vi om? Og sådan nogle ting. Og det vil I høre meget mere om den dag. Så sæt gerne kryds i kalenderen. Så det vil sige, at man bliver simpelthen efter gudstjenesten fra 12:30 til 14, hvis man er med til det. Ja. Og det er alle meget hjertelig velkommen til, skal jeg lige huske at sige. Yes. Og så sker der to helt fantastiske ting. For det første, så skal vi have dåbsgudstjeneste. Kan vi ikke lige få en lille jubi? Halleluja! Yes! Det glæder vi os så meget til. Vi har allerede i hvert fald 3 personer, som har sagt, jeg skal bare døbes, og det skal være søndag den 9. juni. Så hvis du går og tænker, jeg vil faktisk måske kunne godt overveje lidt det der med at blive døbt, så tag lige fat på Thomas. Thomas og Sara, de er her ikke lige i dag, skal jeg lige huske at sige. De er i Oslo, men de er på vej hjem. Men tag fat på Thomas, hvis det er noget for dig. Eller tag fat på mig i dag, hvis det er, så skal jeg nok formidle kontakten. Men i hvert fald dåbsgudstjeneste søndag den 9. juni. Vi glæder os super meget. Og så i juli måned, der glæder vi os også rigtig meget til, at vi skal være sammen med hele Vineyard Danmark på en sommerlejr. Det bliver en fantastisk uge i Kolding, der er heller ikke så langt herfra, skal jeg lige huske at sige. Og det bliver en uge bare fyldt med aktiviteter, med møder, med lovsang, med inspiration, med fællesskab for alle aldersgrupper. Så sæt et stort kryds i kalenderen. Det er en fantastisk både ferie og en mulighed for at blive fyldt op. Der er tilmelding er åben. Så den hedder den her hjemmeside heroppe, og den hænger også herude. Så sæt i hvert fald kryds i kalenderen, og I må også meget gerne tilmelde jer. Yep. Så er det sådan her, efter vi har holdt vores gudstjeneste færdig, så har vi dejlig frokost, så bliver endelig hængende. Vores skønne kok Fatima er i køkkenet, og jeg kan høre begejstringen inde i jeres hoveder, så det er jeg virkelig glad for. Ja. Så bliver hængende, frokost til rimelige priser. Yep. Og sidst, men ikke mindst, så er det sådan, at her i Odense Vineyard, der er vi jo en frikirke, som er støttet af de frivillige gaver, vi får fra medlemmer og fra alle, som har lyst til at støtte op omkring det rent økonomisk også. Så hvis du kunne tænke dig at være med til også at støtte op om det med din økonomi, jamen så tager vi imod hver en gave. Det kan være en enkelt gave på MobilePay. Det kan også være en månedlig fast betaling. Der har vi noget skema, der ligger hernede. Og vi siger bare tak til enhver. Vi skal huske, at Gud han elsker en glad giver. Og er du gæst her i dag? Yes. Nemlig, og er du gæst her i dag, så skal du ikke bekymre dig om det i hvert fald. Ja. Tak for jeres tålmodighed. Vi holder en pause på en 7 minutters tid for at fylde op i kopperne. Så skal jeg huske at sige, at efter pausen her, så skifter vi til engelsk, så det vil sige, at alt, hvad der bliver sagt i mikrofonen, det vil foregå på engelsk. Så kunne du godt tænke dig at få det oversat til dansk, så skal du have fat på et headset, der ligger herude i gangen, og så vil søde Emily, der sidder hernede i boksen, oversætte til dansk for dig. Yep. Godt. Vi holder pause nu.
It was my turn. are switching to English. Attention, we are switching to English. So those of you who are still getting your coffee, getting your tea, naming no names, can you come and find your seat? Ella, can you come and find your seat? We're going to make a start. For those of you who need a translation headset, my speech will be translated into Danish. So I'm going to apologize to Emily in advance. You do a fantastic job. Where I'm from in the UK is called somewhere called Newcastle. I don't know if you know it, but we speak very, 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 very fast. So I'm going to try and slow it down. So do your best, Emily, but I apologize in advance. My name is Abby, for those of you who don't know me. And today we were going to have a lovely speaker called Henrietta come and join us. But unfortunately, she can't make it. So you've got me instead, the consolation prize. I could have tried to do this speech in Danish. It wouldn't have been very good. I watch a lot of Danish TV with my daughter, so I could have probably spoken about animals, maybe clothing, and that's about it. So maybe I could have woven some kind of Noah's Ark or Joseph story together, but it wouldn't be worth your time. So we're talking in English today. And today I want to talk to you about the importance of prayer. The importance of prayer. Last week, Thomas spoke to us about our new Jesus Story communities. These are going to be our way of reaching out to the local community, maybe around a sport or an activity or maybe an age group in a stage of life. Undeniably, this connection is the very fabric and framework of our life. It's quite frankly a reason for living. And if we look in depth, without community, without relationship and connection, we are lonely, starved of attention, and life's not that much fun. God made us this way. It was his intention that we would form these communities on the earth, friendships, families, and be part of it and enjoy it. But not only that, we would be intrinsically linked to him. We would form a relationship with him and a communion. And he called it prayer. Perhaps you've heard of it. So today I want to look at prayer in more detail. Prayer is the way that we communicate with God, very simply. It's the most precious and intimate of connections, something God sacrificed his son to give us. When I thought about what to speak on today, I had an idea forming in my mind. It was nicely coming together, but then as I was showering on Friday morning, which is a luxury spa experience for the mums out there, we don't get to do that very often, God brought into my mind the topic of prayer. Now, usually if you mention prayer to me, as a main topic of something, sorry, Krista, my brain switches off, right? I'm not proud to admit it, but something about the word prayer makes me think of hands together, eyes closed, brain drifting off into a state of boredom. Is that just me? Maybe. Okay, no, great. But over the years, my relationship with prayer has changed and evolved. And my view of it now is that it's a beautiful connection and relationship with the Father, overflowing from a place of intimacy with him. We've all met those prayer warriors, right? Those people who you meet and you can just sense the presence of God is heavy on them. I'm not one of those people, but I have had a journey with prayer. And I want that for you, and I want that for all of us. So I hope that we go away from today with a little bit of a different perspective about prayer. We're going to touch on these four questions today. Why do we pray? Does it make a difference? What about when we don't feel heard, when our prayers aren't answered? And how can we be moved to pray? I must emphasize that prayer is a huge topic, right? And I'm not expecting to cover everything, nor should you expect me to come with all the answers. But this is starting the conversation around prayer. We've got a prayer week coming up in May, so I hope to start this conversation about prayer. We've got a verse for today. It's 1 John 5. Ooh, I need my glasses. I'm going to turn around. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have what we asked of him. And I've also put it in the Message version because I like the way that it sums it up. So the next one is, My purpose in writing is simply this, that you who believe in God's Son will know beyond the shadow of a doubt that you have eternal life, the reality and not the illusion. And how bold and free we then become in his presence, freely asking according to his will, sure that he's listening. And if we're confident that he's listening, we know that what we've asked for is as good as ours. So I'm going to pray, because I'm talking about prayer, so I probably should pray before we start. Thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity today to look at this topic of prayer. We welcome your presence here, and I pray that you would speak to each person about their relationship with you. Would we be open to hearing what you have to say? Amen. Okay, the most fundamental question which got me to a place of wanting to pray was first asking why. Why do we pray? And here are three compelling reasons. Number one, prayer is our foundation. Number two, prayer is in our DNA. It's the very heart of us as human beings. And number three, prayer is our spiritual food. So let's talk about number one, our foundation. Prayer is our foundation. As believers, prayer is central to our faith. It's the solid foundation on which everything is built. If we consider prayer as the way of communicating and staying connected to the Father, then it isn't an optional add-on. As I've traveled from city to city and country to country since school, my friendships have looked quite different. When you are living somewhere, seeing friends regularly, talking to them about their life, you're clued up on what's going on with them. Whereas with someone who I went to school or university with, who lives in the UK perhaps, I don't speak to them nearly as often, and it takes a whole lot more effort to stay connected, to keep that friendship alive. Thankfully, my friends are wonderful, and they forgive my poor text replying. And we do have lots to catch up on when we finally FaceTime or meet up. Now, no matter how frequently you speak to that person, when you have a friendship, at its most basic level, you have to speak to them sometimes, right? You have to call them a friend. Thankfully, in God's grace, there is always a relationship with him open, no matter how often we choose to speak to him, right? Whether we've ever spoken to him, he is always there waiting to respond, to hear all about your struggles, pain, triumphs, and joys. And the more you spend time with him, often the stronger your faith becomes. This relationship is our foundation. We can ask God for direction. He's our guide. He's our compass in the ever-complicated journey of life. And it all starts with prayer. Can I get the next one? Yeah. Okay, so I have a couple of verses here from 2 Chronicles. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. From Jeremiah, then you will call upon me and come and pray to me and I will hear you. And from Luke, I tell you, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. So it's our foundation. Number two, it's in our DNA. I have a quote by Pete Gregg. A lot of my talk I've drawn from Pete Gregg. I think he's a fantastic speaker on prayer. He's written a couple of books. He runs the 24/7 prayer movement. And I think he has a lot of great things to say. So this is what he said. A real relationship with God means walking with him daily, like Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. It means talking with him intimately, like Moses, with whom the Lord would speak face to face as one speaks to a friend. As humans, God created us to be in relationship with him, to pray to him, to not only be dependent on his will over the earth no matter what. He gave us a responsibility and an opportunity to partner with him. And that started with the first man, Adam. As I was delving into this, I found it's very, very interesting that it's in our nature as humans to pray. Adam was with God in the garden, in communion and connection with him, talking with him daily. There was a survey which was released last year on National Prayer Day, and it showed that across 84 nations, 49% of people said that they pray every day. 49%, that's quite high, right? Now, this doesn't just mean Christians, this is everybody, all right? 85% of Americans participate in some kind of spiritual practice, with the most common being prayer. And 9 out of 10 of the people surveyed believed they'd received an answer to prayer sometime in the past year. This is pretty high. We're told that prayer and faith is declining all over the world, and yet these are the results that we get from this survey. It's interesting. Around half of these respondents, 45% of them, said that prayer made them feel less anxious, less depressed, and 1/3 said it made them feel like better versions of themselves. Why is that? I think it's because God intended it this way, right? God's answer is prayer. Okay. Canadian psychologist David G. Benner describes prayer as the soul's native language. One person in every 4 prays the Lord's Prayer each year on Easter Day alone. One person in 6 bows towards Mecca up to 5 times a day. Hasidic Jews stand at Jerusalem's Wailing Wall, dressed in black, and pray. In front of them, between the giant stones of Herod's temple, thousands of handwritten prayers are wedged like badly rolled cigarettes between the bricks. It's worth acknowledging the unending chorus of human longing. Sighs and cries and chiming bells, muttering in maternity wards and scribbled graffiti. In the word of Abraham Herschel, prayer is our humble answer to the inconceivable surprise of living. Then it isn't surprising that we're made for this. God created us to pray, even when it's misdirected to other idols or gods. We are hardwired to pray and to worship. All right, 3 is spiritual food. It gives us our spiritual food. Yes. So St. Augustine, I think it's probably one of his most famous quotes, things that he said was, you have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. So, yes, we are empty and restless without this connection to the one who gives us life and nourishment. The thing that feeds us and sustains us is our time with God, and we cannot survive without it. Not only is our daily bread the earthly things that God knows we need to sustain us, it's our time with him in prayer, our time in the Word of God. So, understanding prayer, does it really make a difference? Right, this is the juicy stuff, okay? This is the stuff we want to get into. Does it really make a difference? Because if it doesn't, what's the point? Some may argue. Recently, I was speaking to a friend of mine who raised the question, do you think it really makes a difference when we pray? Does God really change the course of the future based on what we utter to him or based on our desires or opinions or decision making? Can one simple prayer uttered even with a little faith make a difference? I wrestled with this question. My heart said yes, but where was the proof? What does the Bible say on this subject? I read an interesting book on intercessory prayer as I was preparing for this. And to answer this question, we have to go back and find God's intention. Did he intend for it to matter when we pray? In the beginning, when God created Adam, he commanded him to be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moved on the earth in Genesis 1. In this sense, Adam represents all of us. What God intended for Adam, we can say that he intended for the entire human race. The earth was Adam's assignment from God. That much seems clear. How things went on the earth, for better or worse, depended on Adam and his offspring. Therefore, Adam had a say. He mattered and he could change things, and we can too. If the earth remained a paradise, it was because of humankind. If the serpent gained control, it was because of humankind. God didn't give away his ownership of the earth, but he did assign the responsibility of governing it to humanity. He gave us a stake in the world. And why would God do it this way? Because he wanted to partner with us and have a two-way relationship. He chose from the time of creation to work on the earth through us and not independent of us. So God does work through the prayers of his people. Let's look at some biblical examples of humans changing the course of events through prayer. So I have 3 examples here. 1 is from 1 Kings. It's about when Elijah prays for the rain. 2 is Ezekiel, when God was looking for someone to save Jerusalem. And 3 is from Exodus, and it's about Moses recognizing the importance of being in communion with God. So if we go on to the next slide, I think we can read what Elijah. Yes, okay. I should have made this bigger. I really should have. Okay, let's do it this way. So Elijah said to Ahab, "Up on your feet, eat and drink and celebrate. Rain is on the way. I hear it coming." Ahab did it, got up and ate and drank. Meanwhile, Elijah climbed to the top of Carmel, bowed deeply in prayer, his face between his knees. Then he said to his young servant, "On your feet now, look towards the sea." He went, looked, and reported back, "I don't see a thing." "Keep looking," said Elijah, "seven times if necessary." And sure enough, the seventh time he said, "Oh yes, a cloud, but very small, no bigger than someone's hand, rising out of the sea." "Quickly then, on your way, tell Ahab, saddle up and get down from the mountain before the rain stops you." Things happened fast. The sky grew black with wind-driven clouds and then a huge cloudburst of rain with Ahab hightailing it in his chariot for Jezreel. And God strengthened Elijah mightily, pulling up his robe and tying it around his waist. Elijah ran in front of Ahab's chariot until they reached Jezreel. So, to sum up, Elijah prayed for it to rain and it rained, right? Elijah prayed for it to rain and it rained. Elijah made it rain through his prayers. Pretty cool. Not only did he make it rain here, but in 1 Kings 18, it said that he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced fruit. This doesn't sound like the account of a God who carries out his will regardless. He partners with people. Elijah petitioned him for rain, and so it rained. Elijah petitioned him for drought, and so the rains did not come. The only logical answer to why Elijah needed to pray and why we need to pray today is that God has chosen to work through us and through our prayers. Your prayers are important. Don't let anybody tell you otherwise. In Ezekiel, God is searching for someone to stand up and pray for Jerusalem, to petition him to save it, but no one did, so it was destroyed. Wow. That's a huge revelation. What a huge responsibility we have. We have an invitation God is extending to us to change the course of human history, and it all starts with prayer. I looked for someone among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so I would not have to destroy it, but I found no one. So I'll pour out my wrath on them and consume them with my fiery anger, bringing down on their heads all they have done, declares the sovereign Lord. As I was formulating my thoughts and ideas on this topic. It's quite a crunchy one, right? It's a big topic. It's a controversial topic, but I don't think that means we should shy away from it. We should open up the conversation. As I was thinking about it, as I was preparing for it, I was thinking about all that's unfolding in the world today. We have what's unfolding in Ukraine. We have things with Israel and Palestine, and to name a few, unfortunately. And I found myself moved to do something. These things may feel so overwhelming that we can think, how can my prayers make a difference? But they do. I believe they do. The Bible tells us they can. Please don't hear me that I'm saying that war or horrific events are the will of God. I never say that. But what I am saying is that we have a role to fulfill to stand up to pray. Moses, who had a close relationship with God, said, "Don't even make a way, God, if it isn't your will. Don't send me from this place if you aren't going with me." He knew that relationship and the presence of God was the thing that distinguished him. Do you have answers to prayer to speak about, big or small? Maybe yes, like Kenneth was talking about earlier. Maybe you're all for prayer. You're singing from the rooftops about how God has impacted your life. Saved you, saved a loved one, healed someone, some amazing story like that. But maybe no. Maybe you've been praying for something for a really long time and your prayer hasn't been answered. Maybe you prayed for something specific, a big thing, maybe to save a friend who was sick, and God didn't intervene. It's likely that most of us fall somewhere between those two extremes, but wherever you are on that journey, God wants us to pray. He created us that way, to see people come to church, to faith, to see people healed and made whole, to move hearts, or even the most closed off and stubborn of atheists. And he helped us to pray. Jesus modeled a healthy prayer life for us and laid out a framework called the Lord's Prayer. I don't know about you, but this seems both a huge responsibility and a huge honor all at the same time. Prayer changes things. I guarantee it. I've seen it. When I lived in London, I worked with young people from difficult backgrounds. Some hadn't finished school, some had been to youth prison, some had been involved in gangs, were homeless, addicts, some had educational difficulties like ADHD, autism, dyslexia, and many had mental health issues like depression and crippling anxiety, to name a few. On paper, it seemed like it was a pretty desperate situation, which it was, but I've never seen God move so much as he moved then through the prayers of people. As a team, we prayed each morning. We prayed before the young people came in. We prayed when they left for the day. I'm sure lots of us took stuff home that we prayed for. And I've never prayed so much in the moment. I've never needed prayer so much. I have so many stories, but here's one of a young boy named Rory. Rory had borderline personality disorder, which, if you don't know, is characterized by unstable and intense emotions, explosive anger and mood swings, feelings of emptiness, paranoia fueled by a fear of abandonment. We didn't know this when he started our classes. All we knew was that he'd been kicked out of every other program he'd been on. He hadn't finished school. He was 17. He couldn't really read or write. His self-image was rock bottom. He had never succeeded at anything. We thought he wouldn't come back after the first day, but he did. Day after day after day, he was the first one to arrive each day. Not only that, but he started to thrive and flourish, daring to answer questions in class, completing homework, coming dressed for a suit for a work experience visit we were hosting. And I believe this is because prayer changes things. It changed him. Countless other young people, and countless other young people like him. Now, I'd love to say it was a fairy tale and now Rory is doing really well, but the hard thing is, I don't know. He exploded in anger one day, shouting abuse at us and punching another young person. Safe to say he wasn't allowed to continue the program, and we were devastated. But the next day, we received an email, which read something like the following. I'm sorry for my actions. I let you down. I let myself down. I don't know why I do it. It's like there's something else inside of me. I'm grateful for everything you did for me. We prayed hard for Rory that day and for many days and months after that. We don't know the end of the story, but I do know what happened. I don't know what happened to him, but I do know that prayer changes things. Knowing Rory, that simple email was a huge answer to prayer. Let's go on to the next topic now, which is unanswered prayers. What about when we don't feel heard? Just skip through that bit, Kenneth. Yeah. Many of us walk around with the heartache of unanswered prayers. Sometimes it feels as if God is silent for a short time or a really long time. Sometimes it's a specific thing we're praying for, maybe to heal a friend from a life-threatening disease, and it feels like God wasn't and isn't listening. Maybe you took a risk on where you felt like God was leading you and it didn't work out. Maybe you're suffering physically or mentally. Maybe you long for something that feels like God is holding you back. You're hurt and confused. To borrow from Pete Gregg's book, God on Mute, it is precisely because we believe so passionately in the power of prayer that we must make sense of unanswered prayers. And when we do begin to wrestle openly with this issue, it can never be neat nor an academic exercise for polite discourse, because the question of unanswered prayer touches the deepest, most painful experiences of our lives. We all have friends who have lost their faith because it seems like God was not there when they needed him most. Others continue to believe but live with secret disappointments that drain the joy from their relationship with God. If this is you, know this. God knows what you need. He cares deeply for you. Here are some verses. Cast your anxiety on him, for he cares for you. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feels and cares for it just as Christ does the church. The Lord is good, a refuge in times of trouble. He cares for those who trust him. Cast your cares on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. Okay, I'm coming to an end, coming to a close. I used to be a teacher, so I have to have props. I have to have multimedia, so I thought I'd bring this with me. This is a handmade gift from our friend. She gave it to us for our wedding. And it's a short version of the verse that I shared right at the beginning. It says, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. At first glance, I didn't understand. How can it be that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. Secondly, if something doesn't happen, does that mean it isn't God's will? And thirdly, really, will God give us anything? Then I realized I read it wrong. It didn't say if we ask anything according to his will, he gives it to us. It said if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. He hears us. That's his promise to us. If we ask God something, if we open up a conversation with God, if we pray, he hears us. I want to share a poem with you now. It should come up on the screen next. First, there is prayer. And where there is prayer, there may be miracles. But where miracles may not be, there are questions. And where there are questions, there may be silence. But silence may be more than absence. Silence may be presence muted. Silence may not be nothing, but something to explore. Defy, accuse, engage, and this is prayer. Where there is prayer, there may yet be miracles. We don't know the end of the story, right? We don't know it all. We don't know why God doesn't answer prayer sometimes. But there may yet be miracles. That's the faith that we have. All right, the final point for today is how can we be moved to pray? So how did I get from a place of boredom to a place of seeking those quiet moments with the Father? How did prayer move from a category of a chore to be done to a space and a pursuit to be enjoyed? I started where I was at. I didn't wait for the perfect time or the perfect moment. Sure, prayer for me used to look like praying in the moment, in the situations I've said, in a very real and scary situation. At one time in my life, it looked like getting up in the morning, making a coffee, sitting down and praying through the list of people I had to pray for each day. But right now, with two littlies under two, it looks like turning on some worship music that I enjoy and bringing those people into my mind that I want to pray for. Praying for my husband at work, praying for my children, praying for my friends that come into my mind. Thanking God for all he has blessed me with. And before I knew it, I found myself enjoying that time. Even my kids seemed to understand and slow down and be a little bit more peaceful. It doesn't have to be this way, peaceful, but that's the way it feels for me in this season. So how does it feel for you? Maybe you don't know that yet, and that's okay, but I would encourage you to start today. Put on some music you enjoy. Go for a walk and feel the sun, or in Denmark, the rain, on your face. Savor that cup of coffee you usually chug down. Thank him for it all. And next time you have a moment of chaos or stillness or awe in God's creation, maybe you too will be moved to pray. Because we can be confident of this. Our prayers change things. Prayer is powerful. It's the key to our relationship with the Father. It's part of our assignment on the earth. Let's be a church that understands and uses the power of prayer as our foundation. Amen. All right, we're going to do an activity now. We can come to why we have these pieces of paper on our seats. Very exciting. And if I can invite out my helpers who are coming somewhere over here. Oh, yes, thank you so much. You're all going to get a pen or a pencil. So I thought, like I said, why not start now? All right, there are probably people in your mind or situations or things that you want to ask God for. Maybe you've been praying for a long time for these things, or maybe these are new things. So let's just take a moment now and think about one thing. Maybe you have more, but I think one is just good for now. One thing that you really want to pray for, one person, one situation. And then write it down on this piece of paper. You can write the whole prayer out. You can just write the person's name. You can write it in some kind of secret way if you don't want people to see it. And after that, we're going to come out and we're going to stick it on this piece of paper, and we're all going to pray together for these things. I'm not going to read them out, but we're just all going to pray at once using the power of prayer that God has given us, his will for us to pray for these things. So have a think. We'll have a minute or so to write it down. When you're done, just come straight out and stick it on here. once they've done it themselves, if I can invite the band to come up and play something for us, that would be fab as well. Okay, I think we'll just take 30 more seconds. So if you haven't done it yet, come up and stick your post-it onto the heart at the front. Any last ones trying to get involved? No, okay. I'm not going to read them out, but I can just talk about the general topics. We've got some people they'd like to pray for. We've got places in the world where there's crisis going on. We've got Christians all over the world. We've got family members. We've got work. Got our spouses, all of these things. So I'll invite you to stand now and we're going to pray for these things together. All right, just take a moment. If you want to close your eyes, do that. If you're more comfortable just keeping your eyes open, that's also okay. Whatever way you meet with God, go for it. Be yourself. Just take a minute to just thank Him. Bring to mind all the things you're grateful for, you're thankful for. If you're struggling with that, if it feels like there's not much to be thankful for today, just thank Him for literally the breath in your lungs. Maybe the coffee you had this morning. Maybe you were one of the lucky people who got a croissant before they ran out. Thank Him for that. Amen. I got one. I was a lucky one today. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. All right, I'm a big fan of, I spent some time in Korea, so I'm a big fan of praying out loud for things. So we are going to pray out loud for all of these things here. We know some of them we don't know. Maybe you read someone you came up, maybe some of them are personal things to you. We don't have to know, it's okay. We can just ask God to move in these situations. We can stand in the gap like He called us to do and pray for these people and these situations. All right. There needs to be some kind of organization, so I'm going to say go, and we're going to pray all together, and then I'm going to end it with a loud amen. All right. Let's go. So, Jesus, thank You so much for these different situations. Yeah, we thank You for all of the people who You've put on our hearts and our minds. Will we be a church who's confident in the power of prayer? Would we stand in the gap for these people and these situations? We pray for Your presence, Your power to come. And if you don't know Jesus yet, then this is the perfect time to start to get to know Him, right? Like I said, it doesn't matter if you've never spoken to Him, He's there to listen to you. So if that's you and you'd like to start that conversation with Jesus today, that relationship with God, then just raise your hand. I won't bring you to the front. I'll just pray for you. So just raise your hand if you think, yeah, that's me. I'm in. I want to be in a relationship with God. And as the band continues to play, if you have anything you want prayer for, anything at all, you can come out. We'll have some prayer team over here. Krista will be over here. Some other people will be over here to pray with you. So please don't hesitate. Don't be shy. I feel like it might be a bit of a cultural thing, right? In the UK, we're used to people rushing forward for prayer. They need it. They want it. But I know maybe in Denmark, it's a little bit of a different cultural thing. But go for it. Be brave. Break the cultural norm. Go for it. Get the prayer that you need. Yeah, so I'm just going to finish with one final prayer. So Jesus, thank you so much for meeting with us today, for being here, for speaking to people, speaking to me as well about the topic of prayer. And I pray as we go from this place, we will be inspired to have prayer at the center of everything we do, the foundation. Would we know and have faith that prayer works? And for those people who are struggling with unanswered prayer, I just pray that you would speak to them this week. They would know that you love them and ultimately you hear us. Amen.
Let the King gonna let me down.
thank you, Abby, for sharing such an important issue, important theme. I hope that we can go from here and feel inspired. Maybe it can spark a conversation for you during the lunch. Where are you in your prayer life? Can I help you with anything? Or yeah, and we will soon be having lunch. If you feel like it, you can go up and look at the prayers. Maybe pray some extra for some of it. Maybe carry it into the week with you. Yes, thank you all for coming. We will end the service now. And for those of you who want to stay for lunch, please do talk to someone that you know or someone that you maybe don't know yet. And we will maybe and hopefully see you next Sunday here at the same place and same time. Yes, have an amazing week. Amen.